Hello, and thank you all very much for coming. First of all, thank you to the RUA for inviting me here. And I was very, just on a short note before I start talking, to get Denise's telephone call asking me to deliver this talk about Joe McWilliams was actually a moment that, I wasn't exactly flattered, I was very, very happy, flattered would be the wrong word, extremely pleased to be asked because not only was Joe someone whose company I enjoyed a great deal, a man who I think there's a great sincerity in everything he did, and that I think everyone felt that he was always someone who lifted the room he was in, the company he was in. And it was lovely that Catherine and Simon had sort of, I think, trusted me to do this. So thank you to them. Thank you to the RUA, to Denise, to the Education Committee. It's the first time I've ever done anything with the RUA, and it's very, very nice to be involved. So thank you all very much. And now for some pictures. John Hewitt noted a phenomenon that artists in Ulster seem to appear in generations roughly 10 years apart. Middleton, Thomas Carr, Luke, born around then, O'Neill, Dylan, George Campbell, born around 1920, and the two distinct strains born around 1930, the second which came out of the College of Art, Basil Blackshaw, Terence Flanagan, Martin McKeown. One matter of this, the generation had emerged from the College of Art in the early to mid-1960s, of which Joseph McWilliams was a central figure. He was taught there by John Luke to provide another link with these preceding generations, and was friendly with Colin Middleton. And as Simon mentioned, I did exhibitions of both those artists and had great chats with Joe about his memories of them, and gave me great insight into them both. He began as a landscape painter, relating to and extending the post-war Ulster landscape tradition, which you know through people like Middleton, Terry Flanagan. And I think it's a shame that a lot of these Irish landscapes and also landscapes of France and Italy aren't better known. These are a couple of examples. In 1964, he painted a remarkable Stations of the Cross for the Church of St. Mary's at Akagallon in County Antrim. And from these, which I'll just flick through quickly, we can see the direction which his work might have gone. Here you just get a sense of the totality of it. But it's not unusual to see Joe as an artist whose artistic identity became so strongly connected to the Troubles that it almost defined him. And I'd suggest that while this was important to him, it can also limit our understanding of the full range and the full nature of his art and also of his achievement. As an artist, he was very much of his time. His early work demonstrates an interest in the physicality of the paint surface and in introducing unconventional textures into painting, in a manner that reveals an awareness of artists such as Tapies, as well as the Arte Povera movement. Ultimately, this led to an exploration of how the paintings he was making about the disruption and violence that was around him in Belfast could also include the textures of the damaged streets and the buildings of the city. Living just out of the centre of Belfast, North Belfast, Joseph was thrown into the heart of the Troubles, and the idea of how to treat this as a subject in his art became crucial to the evolution of his paintings in the early 1970s. The paintings of the 1970s are probably the least clearly representational in his work, and also the darkest of his paintings of the Troubles. Riots and Barricades, New Lodge Road, Barricades and People, New Lodge, both painted in 1971. Also Rendezvous with the Rainbow, painted in 1976. Create images that are fragmented, confusing and disorientating. The image emerges through a heavy, hard surface suggestive of violence and destruction. He introduced text as graffiti that only adds to the underlying mood of anger and potential destruction and potential danger. And often even the fact we can only read bits of the graffiti, that there are things coming through that we're trying to read and understand as we look at the paintings. We can sense an artist who is finding ways to interpret a subject that requires a less literal and less representative way of working than simply recording events, instead searching for a visual and a tactile equivalent for what's happening around him. Troubles has become a subject often treated retrospectively by many artists in Northern Ireland and those who have settled here. At the beginning of the 1970s, when the escalation of violence was so sudden and so shocking, It was a challenging subject to take on in a number of ways. George Campbell painted bomb cars. In the work of a number of artists, the impact of the Troubles found expression in the more submerged and less literal manner. I often think of the barbed wire work of Deborah Brown, or the paintings of David Crone, where there are images sort of dissolved and almost like broken glass. But certainly there were few artists who were dealing with it directly. Colin Middleton compared the mood of Belfast at the outset of the Troubles to his memories of the Blitz. And it's interesting to note the ambiguity that many British artists felt during the air raids in cities in England, that while they were aware of the horror of the destruction that they were witnessing, there was a sense of visual excitement and shock in the radically altered urban images that they painted. Even Cecil Beaton's photographs of smoke billowing around St Paul's Cathedral are theatrical and almost fantastical, and reflect the difficulty of absorbing the true nature of these events at the time they are happening. It's notable that Dr. Brian Kennedy made a connection between McWilliams and the Italian futurists in his essay for the exhibition catalogue Colour and March, both in the political resonance of the paintings and the manner in which the political world and the domestic world became bound up together, as well as in the dynamic structure and pictorial urgency of the compositional structure typical of these painters. The vorticist movement in England emerged from futurism, and the complex reaction of vorticist artists such as Nevinson and Wyndham Lewis to the First World War reflects this ambiguity of how an artist can and also should respond when confronted with violence. For Joe McWilliams, there seems to have been a decisive moment when he questioned his role as an artist. The moral necessity he felt to acknowledge a political situation in his work, and his concern that being an artist could easily become irrelevant within Northern Irish society at such a time. He recollected the exciting years of the Troubles, although I would suggest there was some modesty when he said that he had reacted simply and safely in paint. I'm now trying to do something I've never done before, play a short film clip, which actually will show Joe himself talking about this period.
I remember I was painting, working on an idea from Donegal. I was painting in Colour Studio, then it was a small room inside of the house. And I was painting this, and I felt totally uninvolved in the painting, because all you could hear was, at this particular occasion, it sounded like gunfire, but it was slates cracking in our down where Farringdon Avenue was burnt, and all the roofs went off, and people a mile away thought it was shooting. And I mean, it was like, you thought it was shooting as in an army, attacking an army. But, and I'm painting. As far as I was concerned, all of this was gunfire. I thought, this is absolute madness. Me sitting doing something as arcane as this, while the normal people are shooting at each other, throwing stones, setting fire to houses. And I then started to react to what was going on. I always painted what I felt about. I felt about landscape in Cushendall. I felt about Donegal. I felt about the colour of a field beside another field. But when the Troubles started, the one thing on your mind was the Troubles. Do you know what was going on? I'd taught in Ardoin. I lived near Ardoin. My parents lived in the middle of one of the worst riot areas during the entire 50 years, the wretched thing. The violence was an absolute amazing thing to happen initially. Then it became a way of life. And it became, I remember people used to say, where is it all going to end? And my reaction was, we weren't going anywhere. To say, where is it all going to end, almost suggests that there was movement forward in some direction, but there wasn't. There was total stalemate for it seemed like generations. But at the same time, there has always been, which is one good thing, something of hope running through the north.
That's part of an interview with Joe that was carried out by the Ulster Museum during their Art of the Troubles show, and is well worth looking at in full, and the interview done by Anna Leishing. And thank you to Simon for his technical ability in getting the film for me and helping me to get it into the PowerPoint. Certainly it took physical courage to go out and paint in Belfast during these years, whatever you were painting. When you were painting events with any political resonance, this became potentially much more problematic. And while the physical courage cannot be underestimated, Joe responded as artists had responded to the Blitz in London, with the adrenaline-fueled intoxication of danger helping them through situations that must have been fraught with tension. The same adrenaline can be sensed in his paintings. Early on, he made a number of constructions that convey a physical closeness to the events of the time. The pieces of brick and rubble that litter these works, as if they've fallen from a bomb building, are also reminiscent of works by the Boyle family, although used in a very different manner here and for different reasons. It does demonstrate again, however, that Joe was an artist of his time. The subject matter that he focused on did not necessarily separate him from his contemporaries outside Northern Ireland. The subject matter with which he became so closely associated was the 12th of July and the Orange Marches. These are remarkable paintings for many reasons. They make a sustained political statement across a period of several decades, during which he remained unusual here in being so openly and directly engaged with the political situation. They're paintings of enormous energy, paintings that express noise and movement with a skill that again belies his comment that he reacted simply in paint. At times, these paintings can look like a religious procession. At other times, they become almost cartoonish. They express a broader vision of a society that is on the edge, and as such, they become more than paintings of a specific event, but paintings that depict the mood of an entire country that is struggling to cope and that is continually pulling itself back from the brink. These works are also a visual comment on the city in which he lived. The film he made for the BBC, The Way That I Went, gives a very clear sense of how important certain places were for him and how they became overlaid with personal and communal memory, with myth, history and legend, and with a sense of their spiritual significance as much as a material presence.
Distant time, to the very edge of our history. Within these stony confines, the woman who founded Ross Drever lived with her community of sisters, Brona, the sad one. Every time I visit this place, I want to touch these stones, to hold hands through time with that cloistered community. In this very place, over 1,000 years ago, the young chieftain, Fergus, presented Brona with 12 bronze candlesticks and the bronze bell. This gift was an act of reparation for the sin of violence. Since then, Brona's bell has continued to toll. It has sounded down this valley and down all the years of my life. After the Blitz, we returned to another valley, the Lagan Valley, and to the town of Belfast. But I didn't feel as though I was coming home. The clang and clamour of the city traffic and the loud Belfast voices heralded a new day, a new beginning. Poor old battle-scarred Belfast was a jarring experience. The German bombs had badly bruised the north of the city. Vacant windows stared into its drab and tattered streets. Every district had its wrecked and broken buildings. Skeletal rooftops gaped at the skies, and the wind would rattle slates and break the loosened window panes. North Belfast, between the gantries and the mountain, and it was here that I was to grow up. The New Lodge Road, where I was born, has changed a lot, of course. Most of the old terrace houses have gone, but their departure should not be lamented. Picturesque they were if you didn't have to live in them. Little palaces, they were often called, by politicians eager for a vote. Be that as it may, these pavements were great places to play. You could just sit on the step and watch the street. But you had to be careful. Sometimes children on swings would come at you and send you flying off your feet on your way to the corner shop.
But Ross Drever had left its mark on me. I chose to see Belfast as a city in the country. The Cave Hill was only up the road. It wasn't, and still isn't, just a city parkland. It is the real countryside.
I wanted to show that because to me it gives such a great sense of place, the thought about place, the way that he lived in places, that the meaning evolved in those places over years. Because even though he's talking about Ross Drever at one point, then talking about Belfast, it's this sense of belonging, a sense of the importance of where you emerge from, where you are brought up. It all leaves emotional sort of resonance, I think, in his work. And whether or not it's also acknowledged in the title, the paintings of marchers are usually concentrated around a specific place and a very definite set of buildings. Architecture is very important, partly because of its relationship with the figure and events within the painting, and also because Joe represents Belfast over a time when very few people were making paintings of it. The architecture of the city has historical associations and also more recent associations for the airport, sorry, for the artist. So we see, in terms of these paintings, you see buildings dating from sort of the second part of the 19th century, and then you begin to see more recent signs. History is overlaid from the ancient to the more recent. So the architecture has these historical associations and recent associations, and then also for the audience it has associations that are both public and private. There are occasionally modern shopfront signs, graffiti, and the present Belfast is inseparable from its past. And Joe suggests the people are inseparable from their history. While he's best known for his paintings of Orangemen, he also painted Republican parades, the Irish National Foresters, and religious processions in Assisi. All these people take on an identity that is in some way an expression of the city in which they live, uniting them with their surroundings. Just as the image disintegrates and the differing groups become less easily distinguished and begin to coalesce with their surroundings. So what he's looking at really is not necessarily always specifics, but often universal qualities of how we behave in the places in which we live, the different things that drive us. And I'm just going to flick through a few of these, which are very different subjects, because it's interesting to see how paint is used in sort of similar ways across them, how our images are sort of played around with, so that the artist's role and his ideas, in a way, sort of begin to take on more ambiguity than is often thought. In this, perhaps, we can see a more optimistic attitude to Joe's painting, to see some common cause for hope in the enormous energy and vibrancy of the canvases, and in the pleasure he seems to take in colour and the suggestion of noise and movement that he evokes so effectively in all these works. Despite the depression with which he fought privately over many decades, we cannot overlook the rainbow that appears unexpectedly and almost incongruously in his work. This often turns darkness into light. The rainbow appears under a door where we might expect blood. What look like flames are actually a rainbow. If you remember the painting of the car door with that sort of sense of threat that actually comes from that, there's also a rainbow coming out from that. The ambiguity of imagery and signs seems important in appreciating that Joe's paintings are direct, but they're never simple or straightforward in the way that we can read them. Perhaps this is most strongly expressed in the icon series of heads of notable figures such as Pierce and Carson, in which he reminds the viewer that historical truth can become a vehicle that is represented in a limited manner to suit a particular argument. He referred to the painted image disintegrating, much as he seems to have believed that the truth often disintegrated within political discourse. Alongside the recurrence of the rainbow and the energy of colour and movement in the paintings of marches and processions, we can place the paintings of his garden as suggestions of hope, renewal, and recovery. Much as the architecture of Belfast is recurrent and significant in other works, we can also recognise the greenhouse, which becomes meaningful both pictorially and emotionally as a stabilising structural element. These are things that in his work are, in a way, as personal as the paintings of Belfast. I think he's often associated with a particular political standpoint, with particular subject matter. And there's something refreshing, I think, about going back to these paintings and looking at something that is so entirely personal. And also it gives a great sense of a sort of someone who is looking for positivity amongst in the middle of a very difficult situation. Often we can see a particular private passion that defines the manner in which someone paints. And I always think of both James Humbert Craig and Colin Middleton, who are both keen fishermen, having the particularly intimate experience of how a landscape looks when one is there, still, silent and watching day in, day out, as the light and the weather change. Similarly, the paintings of a gardener see growth and renewal that the ordinary viewer of these paintings would not. One could read these works alongside the paintings of the Troubles. Perhaps the way that society deals best with social and political conflict is for individuals to find their own private peace and personal understanding, much as Voltaire suggested that one must cultivate one's own garden. Certainly, most of the people Joe painted are defined by their allegiances to groups or by an historical understanding of their own names or achievements. There are few who are just shown as isolated individuals within their own life. And it's interesting, again, in terms of a more historical comparison, to look at someone like Bonnard, who retreated to his own garden during the Second World War, and that paintings that find hope in a particularly difficult situation are not necessarily irrelevant because they do not deal as directly with the events around you as to my mind, also, the self-portraits are very striking in this context. There aren't many of them, and again, as with Bonnard's remarkable late self-portraits, they almost seem to catch the artist himself off guard, suddenly confronting himself in a bathroom mirror or about to step out of a painting of his own garden. In his self-portraits, Joe still remains elusive, but he is very much present in the paintings of marches, in the landscapes or the garden paintings. The late paintings in which a shadow, perhaps his own, fall across the garden are moving and demonstrate that an artist who expresses so much of himself throughout his work is perhaps least comfortable when having to turn in on himself. But to examine Joe's legacy in full, one must go beyond his painting and look at his career as a teacher of art, as a writer in art, as a gallerist who facilitated the careers of many young artists. I know there are people here in the audience who had the benefit of exhibiting at the Cave Hill Gallery, and anyone who either was involved there as an artist or involved there as a visitor will be aware of the remarkable roster of artists that they managed to put together. The Christmas shows included people who've achieved great success, and also always including new artists. There's always a sense that you would find, you'd make discoveries there, you'd find people whose work you didn't know, and they'd be well worthwhile discoveries. He's also, I think, a rather unique commentator in the cultural landscape of Belfast, and I'd say one of the great pleasures for me of actually preparing this talk has been that the website that Simon has set up has many of the articles that Joe wrote for the Irish News, and I would recommend anyone, would it'd be well worth spending a couple of hours looking through those. He's also president of the Royal Ulster Academy, which makes it particularly appropriate doing this here, and a very energetic president, and someone who, again, I know the help he gave to young artists by encouraging them to show, by selecting work. I mean, he was always a positive figure in people's lives. These various careers ran in parallel to his painting career, but in many ways they reassert the position he'd taken as a painter, that he was prepared to stand up for the values that he felt were vital and prepared to engage in discussion about the matters that seemed to him important and ensure that discussion took place. Despite sort of certain controversies, I think what we look at is the ongoing discussion that emerges from those. And I know he was someone who sort of, in terms of his place within contemporary art here, always stirred things up, always liked to make sure that people just didn't do things by habit, that people thought about what they're showing, how they're showing work, really looked hard at art, which is a crucial thing. As a teacher, and also during his presidency, and just importantly, through the work at the Cave Hill Gallery with Catherine, Joe provided so many opportunities and encouragement to young people that it's no wonder that Simon McWilliams has become one of our most significant artists. Rather than Joe's thought at the beginning of the Troubles convincing him that art was not relevant in Belfast, he was determined to ensure that art actually became something that all people here could become involved in and could in some way have a positive effect on every life. A number of his articles can be read on his website, as I mentioned, and while they're extremely funny, they also do express a genuine anger at the manner in which he saw contemporary art withdrawing into a world that, despite deliberately drawing from popular culture and often rather banal aspects of life, was becoming increasingly irrelevant to most of society. For Joe, art should be meaningful. It should be direct in its communication. It should be for everyone to enjoy. And also, he felt very strongly that all children and young people should be given the tools to make it and also the tools to appreciate it. There's a consistency here in the ambition and his values, which we find that runs across his painting, his writing, all his activities in the Northern Irish art world. That in all those different aspects his legacy can be found. It's very difficult to take away one thing to say he's just a painter. He's just a painter of the Troubles, just a painter of marches. There is a balance in the work always. There's perhaps a frustrated landscape painter in the way that his work was, his work early on was almost diverted into looking at what was happening around in Belfast. There's a, to me, there's someone who would have, had he been more of that sort of person, painted many very interesting self-portraits, because I think there's a very interesting sense of what the human presence is about, what the personality is about, what the artist looking at himself sees in the mirror. Despite the very complete body of work that he's left behind, I think we see all these other channels he could have gone down and produced very, very interesting work alongside the other work that he made. His paintings present us with an emotive and a highly personal reaction to the Troubles at a time before the artistic response to these events had become cultivated by an accepted political and a social discourse. To my mind, that is why they can still be shocking. That's why they still can engage and they can still challenge a very broad audience. And I think that's what we see, that he's someone who has transcended the usual audience for art in many ways. He's someone who has engaged many, many people with art, whether they are viewers, whether they're artists themselves. I think as a legacy, that's very, very difficult to beat. Thank you very much.